Very good morning to all of you. I am fellow of National Academy of Sciences, India, and representing here INSA. And my place of work is Indian Council of Agriculture Research, National Research Center on Plant Biotechnology, and I'm working at Delhi. As in our first presentation, Dr. Jeffrey mentioned that genomics is playing a very important role, particularly technological advancement in genomics. I would like to inform you that my expertise is also in genomics, and I was part of first crop genome sequenced rice, and then subsequently tomato, both paper appeared in Nature 2005 and 2012. So looking at the theme of this particular conference, that science for poverty eradication and sustainable development, I have chose this particular topic, biotechnology for sustainable growth of Indian agriculture and poverty eradication. In this particular presentation, I would be showing you certain example how science-led agricultural innovation gave dividend to Indian economy and how that's helpful in eradication of poverty. So, showing some of the historical perspective of Indian agriculture, Indian agriculture is 9,000 years old, and you can see here, even during those days, 4,500 BC, there were development of big dams to make irrigation possible to increase agriculture production. Under British rule, Indian agriculture went global with cotton, indigo, opium, and rice, and entering international trades. One of the most striking development which took place during this regime is the establishment of Imperial Agriculture Research Institute in 1905, which is the now deemed university, and the place where I work has in one of the institute that has changed whole scenario of agriculture. But during those days, if you see agriculture performance during 1891 to 1946 was depressing, with annual growth rate of 0.4%, with stagnant food grain production. So one of the important question was how to feed that millions of population which we have. But during those years, in 1943, Bengal famine happened, and many of you might be aware of this particular famine, where food output declined at an annual rate of 0.7%, whereas population growth was at 1% increase. And because of this whole famine, more than 2 million people died due to food security. So that was a major challenge for Indian government to feed millions of people. And that happened with the introduction of semi-dwarf varieties of wheat, which was brought by Dr. Norman E. Warlock from International Institute, and the very institute, Indian Agriculture Research Institute, that gene was introduced in traditional varieties to make them dwarf varieties, and we saw green revolution in India because of these four or five reasons, because of dwarfing genes coupled with irrigation facilities, improved hybrid seeds, chemical fertilizer, pest management, farm credit, and political will. And because of these all components, we could see a lot of development in Indian agriculture. Now you see the present scenario. India has only 2% of world's land with 4% fresh water, and what it has only 16% of world's population and 10% of the cattle which is feeding this particular on this particular planet. Between 1951 till date, our food grain production has increased 5 times, milk production 8 times, fish production 11 times, horticulture 6 times, meat 8 times, and eggs 27 times. Still, because of all these advancements, poverty and hunger percentages have also decreased. And you can see these things have been shown in a typical graphical form, the increase in various agricultural commodity and its production. If you are familiar with Indian particular region of India, Indo-Gangetic Plain, is highly fertile land. And I'm showing you some examples from there because of these 5 states where we have made comparisons of Punjab, Haryana, Bihar, where poverty is very high. And the status of poverty in Indian Gangetic Plain, you can see it is It has decreased from 1973 to 2004 and 2005 in almost all these states. And incidence of hunger has also decreased in these all these states. It's particularly eliminated in Punjab and Haryana, which is highly productive land for wheat and rice. And in rest of the states, it has also declined. Similarly, life expectancy has increased in all these states, around 57 years to 67 years, and all these states, even in India, life expectancy has increased. And because of all agriculture production and other related issues, all these things happened in India. Still, we have a lot of challenges, and you all are aware because of our population growth. And the challenges are, Indian population is growing continuously, both in rural as well as in urban India. And now we have around 1,210 million population, and which has grown more than 31% after 1971, and is still growing. So the challenge, and because of this growing population, India's global hunger index is also very high. Many of you might be aware that majority or around 62% of the world's hungry live in Asia, and out of those, 25% only in India. So we have a lot of challenges ahead to feed millions of hungry mouths. Now, if you see these comparisons over years from 1951 to 2021 and some prediction, the population is continuously growing, okay, whereas this pace of growth has not been taken place in agriculture. But still, from a begging bowl before independence, 1947, now India has surplus grain production, and we are able to have a lot of production of grains. There are many reasons of poverty, which probably many of you are aware. In spite of all agricultural development, if you see area which we need for cultivation, more land, has not increased much during these few years. It is almost static. So in spite of all these problems, in future we need, the demand for food and food products are like this. It's increasing day by day, and we have to feed all our populations because of this increased demand and what to do with that. So for that, we have to resort to certain innovations, more innovation in agriculture, and biotech is one of the important components of Indian agriculture, in which I'm going to show some of the interesting examples which have really made difference in different commodities. And this is one of the first biotech product in India, which was named as Pusa Jai Kisan. A very high-yielding mustard variety is developed at our institutes in 1994. It was released. And you can see it gives 17 to 20% higher yield, and it is grown in more than three states, which are predominantly growing oilseed mustard, and it is still ruling these states during these past 20 years. Another product which we developed using biotechnological intervention is development of cytoplasmic male sterile system, which is important for development of hybrids. And two hybrids, NRC Sankar Sarso and Coral 432, have already been released in India for more production in oilseed mustard. There's another example here. First marker-assisted selection-derived rice varieties. In biotechnology, many of the people are aware only of GM technology, but there are other techniques which gives dividend. And this is one of the important rice variety which was released at our institute, and which is resistant to bacterial leaf blight, carrying three genes for resistance using DNA markers. DNA markers are like this. The plants which contain that gene have this particular band, and those doesn't contain missing that gene. So this particular variety have superiority of 11.9% over the existing varieties of basmati rice. Similarly, using same technology, marker-assisted selection, another mega variety of rice which is grown is in southern India that has we have incorporated three genes for resistance to bacterial leaf blight. Again, using marker-assisted selection, this variety has gone to the farmers, and particularly subsistence and also small farmers. In case of maize, we have used marker-assisted selection to develop a quality protein maize hybrid in 2008, named as Vivek QPM9, with high yield as compared to the existing varieties of maize, which also contains besides high yield, it also contains high protein, which is very important for the poor farmer as well as different populations. This is one of the classical examples where single gene can make difference here. It's a, if you know geography of India, eastern India is highly prone to floods. And when we grow rice there, during floods, all rice is damaged and you can't see anything and can't harvest anything here. What the gene which was cloned by Erie in collaboration with the US partner is in public domain. That gene has been incorporated in varieties grown in southern, eastern India. And because of insertion of one gene, you can see that all these varieties are survived under flooding condition when floods remain 10 to 18 days and single gene can make huge difference here. Similarly, another important trait which we are considering in rice is also important for subsistence farmers because farmers are unable to spray most of fungicides and herbicides to control diseases. This is rice blast. It kills whole rice plants. The gene which we cloned, PI54, has now, when you introgress in these resistant variety, susceptible variety, this is susceptible variety. Because of disease, it has completely killed. But when we incorporated this PI54 gene, which we cloned at our center, and in this particular variety, you can see the status of these lines because of introgression of one gene, it is becoming resistant. And now, last year, we released a new variety, PUSA 1612, containing two genes for blast resistance, PIG5 and PI54, and you can see their grain characteristics as well as plant architecture is the same, and all these lines were developed using marker-assisted selection. This is non-GM approach. Now, coming to GM approach, which we have used for increased production, and this is a classical example of any biotech-led product here, BT cotton story in India. You can see here, BT cotton was started cultivation in 2001 and 2, and after 10 years of its cultivation, the farm income has grown from $14.6 million to $21,000. And number of fungicide sprays has also decreased. And also pesticides spray on cotton, which was 5,748 metric ton on cotton. And after introduction of BT cotton, it has gone down to 222. Only few spray now you do on cotton for control of this particular insects. Now, very interesting analysis have been done by various studies on BT cotton in India, which has played an important role on because of adoption of this technology to reduced chemical pesticides by 37%, increased crop yield by 22%, and increased farmer profit by 78%. This is the story of one single gene which has made a lot of difference in India and particularly in the area where cotton is grown. Because of BT cotton, even calorie consumption has also increased in the power or poor people of these particular regions which they are dependent on subsistence agriculture. Because of introduction of BT technology, it has reduced food insecurity by 15 to 20% among Indian cotton growers. So you can see the impact of technology, if you use judiciously, it can play dividend to the farmers as well as to the different communities. Now, there are some considerations which we have to follow because of these use of new technologies as well as science-led agriculture. We have to do some more allocation of funds of GDPs for agriculture, health, and education. There should be increased access to food and education for rural masses, linkage of all development programs with inclusive growth of the society, and to bridge the increasing gap between poor and rich, and then making agriculture more remunerative. And I'm sure that because of with some these examples, you might have noticed that if you make proper use of technology, we can increase farmer income as well as we can reduce poverty to a greater extent. Before bind up, I would like to acknowledge Indian Council of Agriculture Research, where I work, Indian National Academy of Sciences, those who have given me opportunity to come here, and more importantly, Brazilian Academy of Sciences, particularly Dr. Marcos, who has sponsored my visit and invited me to attend this particular symposium. I have greatly benefited because of my presence here. Thank you very much.